Good evening to all the audience that listening to this lecture. My name is Daniel Asso, and I'm directing this lecture to the American people in Central America and Canada, and all the Jewish community around the world that listening to this lecture. I'd like to share with you, first of all, through the Talmud, we know in Gemara, Sanhedrin, and Perek Chelek, page Tzadik Chet, Amud Aleph, the Gemara says that Amar Rav, En Ben David Ba, Ad Shetit Poshet Amalchut, Bechol HaOlam Kulo. Meaning the Messiah, son of David, Mashiach, son of David, will not come till the kingdom of Rome will spread all over the world. 9 months before the Messiah will come. And same thing, the Gemara doesn't really specify who is the kingdom. It doesn't. The Gemara in Sanhedrin doesn't say Rome, but it said the Malchut. Actually, Pashet the Malchut, till the kingdom will spread all over the world. But the quote in the Gemara refer to Rav, which is Tana and Amora, and he specifically explain himself in the Gemara, Masechet Yoma, page 10, by saying 9 months before the Messiah will come, then the Persian will fail in a war under the kingdom of Rome, meaning Rome will rule the world and spread its kingdom all over the world 9 months before Mashiach, son of David, will come. It's pretty clear for the Talmud what's coming. And the Tosfot in Masechet Avodah Zarah, Daf Bet Amud Bet, in Dibur HaMatchil, Mashcha Malchutayu, explained that the kingdom of the Persian and Rome will go on till the Messiah will come. And then Tosfot precisely speaking about the fact that since we know that Divrei Rav, what Rav say in Masechet Sanhedrin, that 9 months before the Messiah will come, then the Persian will fail in a war under the Roman Empire. And we do know that those kingdoms, the Persian, which is head of the Arabs, of the Arab countries or nationality, and the Rome, which represents the Christian or the Edomite race, then the fight between them will go on till 9 months before the Messiah will come, and then the Edomite will rule the world for the last 9 months before the Messiah will come. So the 9 months represent the pregnancy and the deliverance of the redemption of the end of time. And Chevle Mashiach, obviously, that's the last 9 months before the Messiah will come, will be a tough time for us. And it's just like Chevle Mashiach, we speak about the great sufferer before the Messiah will come, before the birth of the redemption of the nation of Israel and the entire world as well. But anyways, what I would like to increase awareness by this lecture is that we as an Israelis and the Jewish community around the world are concentrating on one enemy, which is the Arab League and the Islam, and we don't pay attention to another angle of attack, I would say, which is basically the Edomite, and we are in a big cultural fight with the Edomite, and this fight is being described by the Torah as a fight from the ancient time between Jacob and Esau, not Ishmael, which is the Arabs, but rather Esau, which is the Edomite, which is Christianity, basically, or you can say even the Amalekite, basically, they came from the same source, the Edomite. It's a fight from the dawn of human history between Jacob and Esau. It's a fight over the blessing and over the inheriting the blessing of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the father, our forefathers, inheriting the blessing of God, and who gonna get the blessing, whether Esau or Jacob, and they fight from the stomach of Rebecca. In the ancient time, from the dawn of human history, throughout human history, till Vayavek Ish Imo Adalot HaShachar, till the sunrise of the redemption in the end of time. We don't say Ve'alu Moshiim Mehar Tzion Lishpot Et Har Ishmael. We don't say Ve'alu Moshiim Har Tzion Lishpot Et Mecca, or Ve'alu Moshiim Har Tzion Lishpot Et Medina. No, we don't say that. We say Ve'alu Moshiim Har Tzion Lishpot Et Har Esav, which is the Edomite. Again, we see clearly that the cultural fight throughout history, from ancient time to the end of time of human history, it's between Esau and Jacob, and it's a cultural fight over the spirituality, over the blessing, over it's a cultural fight, and just to understand better, if we're gonna take off our own personal glasses, and we're gonna put the glasses of the Rishonim and the Tanaim and the Moraim to view the end of time period and to understand it better, then we're gonna see clear that Aramban didn't see the Ishmaelite as the greatest enemy of the end of time. When he argued with Peri Paul, which is a representative of the church before the king of Sfarad in Europe, then Peri Paul, the representative of the church, which is a Jewish converter to Christianity, was asking Ramban, why is it that in your Gemara, in Perek Chelek in Sanhedrin, the Messiah is sitting by the gate of Rome? What is he doing at the gate of Rome? And then Ramban responded that basically, since what there is in Rome, Rome represents the Vatican, Rome represents a culture that were able to rule the world in a human history, in a period of, and they destroy the temple of Jerusalem, and the second temple of Jerusalem, and he responds, you are our first enemy, and therefore the Messiah is sitting there by the gate of Rome to wipe you out, to destroy you. And basically, you got to understand that Aramban is saying, when he was asked, and in the book of war, Milchamot, Ramban used to do arguments, theological arguments, and he was saying that when Moshe Rabbeinu, when he was born, he didn't come as a Messiah to redeem us from Egypt. He's a first redeemer, and he didn't come when he was born. He didn't come when he was growing till the age of 80, but he came only when he went by being a messenger of God to Pharaoh, and he told him, "Let my people go." Then he came, and that's what's going to take place in the end of time when our Mashiach, son of David, will go to the Pope and ask him, "Let my people go." That's what the Ramban says. So the Ramban probably saw the Pope in Rome just equal to the Pharaoh in Egypt, and he saw the Edomite of of the end of time as the Egyptian, and basically it's a big surprise. What kind of power the Pope have? He doesn't have any power. It seems like he didn't have any power, but actually we probably don't really recognize or don't see what behind the veil. But actually, Ramban is pretty right. He is. There is a power behind the Vatican, and the power behind the Vatican is unclear to us because they work and operate behind the veil. It's a shadow government, which is, you know, operating behind what we, behind the scene, let's put it like that. There is a concept called New World Order. And the concept of New World Order, meaning a group of people that they're interested in creating one world government, one economic power. And they think that it's better to wipe out all the nationality around the world and all the different religion around the world, and to create one world government and maybe even one world religion. And basically the concept of New World Order, it's not exactly a conspiracy no more. We can see compatible evidence to it when Henry Kissinger is speaking about New World Order, when Bush, the president, the father, and the son were speaking clear and loud about the plan of New World Order. Basically, when you hear Obama speak about New World Order, so therefore, it's not a conspiracy theory, like many people think. There is a plan of a group of people which a lot of respected people speak about. And that plan, basically, it's a pyramid of power, which we should ask ourselves, who is standing on the top of that pyramid? And basically the answer is the Pope in the Vatican is standing in the top of this pyramid, but not the white one, but there is another pope, and the pope behind the scene is the black pope, which is in Rome, which is standing on the top of the pyramid. This pyramid of power basically tends to operate and to control governments, and to operate when our consciousness is sleeping. And that's a strategy that exists since 1540, when Jesuit order inside the Vatican was founded by Loyola, which is the founder of this order. At the year 1776, there was a professor called Adam Weisbrot, which were part of the Jesuit order. And he got an order from the Jesuit order to pretend that he is leaving the order and to enter. He was at the same time part of the Freemason, which is an esoteric group of people. And he was able to create a secret society inside a secret society of the Freemason, which become the top of the secret society, and they call themselves Illuminati. The Illuminati was found by Adam Weisbrot, by a Rothschild family that desire the money of the planet Earth to themselves, and the Jesuit order that desire the control under the Pope, because they swear and they believe in the prophecy as a divine power, and therefore they work just like an army. It seems like that, like if they're spiritual people, but it's the exterior metaphor. Basically, they operate just like an army, and their goal is to control the world and to bring the world under the control of the Pope in Rome. And the follower of Shabtai Tzvi, which is Yaakov Frank, the Frankistin, also they want to wipe out the morality of the Jews, which is the belief in the transcendental power of God. Shabtai Tzvi and Yaakov Frank, they came to a conclusion of an atheist conclusion that there is no. Basically, at the end, they came to an atheist conclusion, and they want to wipe out the belief in God. They want to wipe out the morality of Judaism and their influence on the Western society. So therefore, those three components, which is the Yaakov Frank society and the Jesuit order and the Rothschilds, three of them with Adam Weisbrot, that founded this Illuminati group in 1776, they start to operate underneath to penetrate any government and to control, to try to achieve control over the world. Now, the problem is that nowadays we see that many presidents in the United States basically share this concept of New World Order, and they were able to succeed to penetrate the CFR, Counseling Foreign Relations, which is another arm of that group, of trying to basically achieve the New World Order. And they don't operate necessarily as patriot Americans. They operate for the goal of the New World Order through the media, through different ways, to influence and to control the mind of the population through the media. How the Wall Street component, which is the bankers of Wall Street, and few families, like Rockefeller families, Rothschild families, and Morgan families, and some others, that basically they're the bunkers of that same group, that same, I would say, mafia of the Illuminati. And there is another group, which is the politicians of that mafia, that's trying to achieve the same goal, the New World Order, which is called the Bilderberg, which is 120 politicians gathering together in Europe and making decision for together what's going to take place in the world so they can achieve the New World Order each year. And it's possible to see them. There is a compelling evidence that they exist. There is many people that could testify and even show clips and show the gathering as well over the internet. But what do exactly, what relate to us as Jewish people in America? I would say I'm directing my lecture here to the Jewish community in America. That group of people, basically they're atheist people, they present themselves as a believers, but it's a deception. They're trying to wipe out religion and to create one world concept, which is not necessarily belief in the transcendental power or something above nature, but a religion of nature, to believe in nature. So therefore, as a international belief. So therefore, they're fighting the concept of the Bible. They're fighting Judaism, and they claim that basically Judaism is the mother of the religion in the Western society, which is Christianity, and Islam as the left and right arms of Judaism, or they came out from the emerged from the Bible, and therefore the source and the enemy of that of the New World Order basically going to be Judaism, the Bible vision, and of the end of time, and they have their own vision of what they see human society is supposed to achieve. Now they want to depopulate the world, and through many books we see, for example, a book of the UN Agenda 21. Clearly, we can see through that they're intending to depopulate the world. And depopulate meaning, in many ways, there is a plan during the Day of Peace, how to do it and how to avoid a natural growth of big families, and through many things, many ways, from medicines, through food. But there is some other plans. For example, we do see in the United States by now 800 concentration camps in America that's being spread all over the country, all over the United States, Central America. And even through the map of Google, it's possible to go down and see them and see the places. The problem is that I would not say it if the American government would reject or deny the fact that they exist. But they don't deny the fact that they exist. They just try to explain why and what the reason they exist. But we, as a Jew, we don't have to accept explanations when we have foundation for Holocaust. we're not supposed to believe that the human nature was changed from 70 years ago from Germany to America, because we supposed to at least learn something from the Holocaust of Europe about the nature of humanity. I think that any Jew should consider and think if there is a foundation for Holocaust in my country, should I go on living in that same place and accepting the different explanations of why they exist? The fact that the concentration camps, 800 concentration camps that can contain 50 million people, exist in America, it's undisputable. The government agree, and they don't deny the fact. The fact that there is millions of disposable coffins, which are called casket liners, that actually they're basically disposable coffins all over Madison, Georgia, and some other places in the Midwest, just like Dan Buhan was able to find and to testify and to show over the internet that they exist. And I know that we as a Jewish community, we're not exposed to the internet, but when there is a dangerous, when we need to increase awareness, when we need to be careful, we should watch out to see not only the truth, but, a Dayan supposed to see also in reality, not only through the scriptures and the Torah, but also to watch out from reality, but to judge emet la'amita. Emet la'amita, it's also to see emet, which is the Torah, Torah emet natanu, but to see also reality and to put them together and to be able to view a three-dimensional picture of what we stand before. I'd like to point another point that Ari HaKadosh, Ari Zal, is saying that anything that we want to learn about the redemption of the end of time, we have to or to study it from Egypt. Ki me Mitzrayim arenu niflot. The prophet Micha is saying in chapter 7, by the end of the chapter, before he finishes his book, prophecy book in the Bible, he says, Ki me Mitzrayim, just like the days of Egypt, I will show miracles the nation of Israel by the end of time. So everything that we want to know about the future, we should stare and learn from the Egypt exile and the redemption of Mitzrayim. And therefore, Rabbeinu Bechaye in Parashat Bo is saying that he has a compellable evidence that by the end of time, the Edomite will get 10 plagues, just like in Egypt, Dam, Tzfardea, Kinim, Arov, and he's proving it through blood, frogs, and all those flags from Egypt. The same way, that's what's going to take place in the end of time, just 10 times greater than what we saw in Egypt. And so basically, a Ramban is viewing the Edomite as of the end of time, as the Pope, as a Pharaoh, and Rabbeinu Bechaye is proving through Haggai, Zecharia, Malachi, through the Bible, through the scriptures, that the Edomite is supposed to by the end of time to to be hit by God, ten plagues, just like in Egypt, just in a greater way, 10 times than in the ancient times. So maybe we missed something. Well, maybe we were focusing on the fight with the Arabs, which is another angle of attack of another enemy. But if we can see in Yalkut Shimoni and be able to study from Yalkut Shimoni that Yalkut Reuveni, I'm sorry, Yalkut Reuveni, is saying, "Kum Mashiach ben Ephraim v'aseh mishpat b'parsim ha'rashayim ha'orim halalu." The Messiah, son of Joseph, is supposed to take care of the Arabs by the end of time. The Messiah, son, Mashiach, son of David, he is fighting another fight. It's more of a cultural fight. It's over the soul. It's over the many souls that we lost throughout human history, that converted to particularly Christianity or emerge with the Adamite through assimilation, which is the quiet Holocaust, like I call it. We call it the assimilation Holocaust that we can see through America, Europe, and just in order to you to understand, you have to understand one thing, that we are in the Edom exile. The people that destroyed the Second Temple of Jerusalem were the Roman Empire, and the Roman Empire were conquered by Christianity, and since then, Inquisition and Crusades and many executions and many suffer throughout that exile, and we tend to forget our history, our 2,000 years of history, that our greatest enemy were the Edomites. And more specifically, the Vatican, which tend to rule Christianity throughout those thousands of years. And basically, we ought to understand one more thing. We now, after the Second World War, tend to think that something changed, and since, throughout those 2,000 years, our greatest enemy was the Edomite, but now we have 8 wars with the Arabs, and we tend to fight over land with the Arabs here in Israel, and all the terrorism of the Muslims, but you got to understand one thing, that even nowadays, since 1946, right after the Second World War, and till now, the quiet Holocaust, which is the assimilation Holocaust, were able to hurt the existence and the survival of the human nation, even in a greater, I'd say, heat. Greater than harming us much more than the Arabs, because we lost through those 70 years over 7 million people through assimilation, and that's why exactly that's a metaphor of it. It's so Jacob is fighting with the angel of Isa, and he got hurt with Gid Anashe. And Gid Anashe represents Anashe, which is Gid Anashe. It's to forget, to cause the children of Jacob to forget the existence of God and to assimilate. That's the assimilation. That's why he is walking toward the redemption. Jacob is walking the redemption, and he was able to win, but he doesn't walk right. He got hurt in his in his leg, and he got hurt in Gidon Asher, and that's why we don't eat Gidon Asher, but it represents, through Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai in the Zohar says, it represents the assimilation. It represents that the angel of Isa, of the Adamite, were able to hurt his children of Jacob and to cause them assimilation and to forget, because it's the Gid Anashe, it's the Gid of the birth. That's what Zohar saying, to give birth. Therefore, the Toladot of Yaakov, you know. But I would like to emphasize on the point that when, if the fact that we see 800 concentration camps around America, and we see millions of disposable coffins, and America giving many different kind of explanations and things are, and the explanations are not exactly clear. Every one of us is supposed to think whether what's going on, and the, all the red lines, all the red, lights in his cockpit supposed to turn on, and to think, well, what am I doing here? I'm calling you people that are living in Central America to listen to Rabbi Chaim Kanievsky that says a month ago, I directed his voice towards you to tell you, come back to Israel, and something is about to happen in America. We probably predict through the Gemara, through our predictions, through the prophecies, that a big world Holocaust is about to take place, because the New World Order want to depopulate the world in 90% and to leave only 500 million people in the world. And who are those people, undesirable people, they don't want them to be exist? Well, definitely, since the New World Order, it's an atheist group of people that pretending to be, you know, a part of the population so they can be popular and control them. But actually, underneath the carpet, they're basically a group of atheist people that want to wipe out any religion. So therefore, you got to understand, we as a Jewish people in a great dangerous around the world. We need to come to Israel in the end of time, because when the Third World War will take place and we see it coming, then the world will be, say, a flood of fire, that the land of Israel will be the only ship of Noah of the end of time from the flood of fire. We got to understand also that the Shekhinah and that went to the exile right after the destruction of the Temple of Israel, because we went on exile, and at Chashivat Demiyom Ad Itcharib Bet Migdash Ad Alana Bevit Adili, said Eliyahu Navi, you, Knesset Israel, you thought that me, Shekhinah, Akdosha, I left the earth to heaven. No, I went to the exile with the nation of Israel. That's what Patach Eliyahu Navi is saying. And basically, now it's about time that the redemption is about to come. And therefore, the Shekhinah is leaving the exile and coming back to Har HaMoriah, to Jerusalem. And therefore, we do see it coming. We see that basically the world will start to fight with one another around the world. It's going to be like a huge hurricane that's going to create the Third World War. But, and they out to come with that hurricane or that tornado to fight over Jerusalem, so naturally it's going to be look like if Jerusalem will be, or Eretz Yisrael will be, the most dangerous place, naturally. But actually we have to put in mind two things. When there is a hurricane, and the eye of the hurricane is the right place to be, the most safe place, because everything around will be will basically wipe out, and that's going to be the only place to be, and to be safe. But another point is that God is bringing that first world war to come, and because the new world order wants Jerusalem to be the capital of the new world order, and therefore they're going to come here to control the world from Jerusalem, because they want to fight the religion of the world, the big three religion, and they see Jerusalem as the homeland of those huge religions. They want to defeat them in their homeland and to wipe them out from field of human history. So therefore, they're going to come specifically to Jerusalem, but then they don't realize that it's a plan of God to bring them here together, because the New World Order group that exists now contain now also the Arab League and Christian countries together, and basically we got to understand the two temples of Jerusalem were destroyed by the first one by the Babylon, which is an Iraqi country, which is a basically Muslim country, and the second temple were destroyed by the Christian, basically the Edomite, and God is about to bring them here to take a revenge from them, and therefore they're going to fight one another, just like the prophet Zechariah is saying, and they're going to fight one another here and kill one another here to a point where 9 months before the Messiah, Mashiach, the son of David, will come, then the Ishmaelites will fall and before the Roman Empire, and they're going to control for 9 months the entire world and cause a world holocaust to the entire world. But we got to understand one thing. The nation of Israel were the first one to experience slavery in Egypt, to direct humanity out of slavery. And they went through, the Jewish nation went through Holocaust, first one to go through Holocaust to show the world the way out of the world humanity Holocaust that will occur in the end of time by the New World Order. It seems like they have a good intention to unite, but it's a cover story. The real story is to take over the world by private hands and to control who's going to live and who's going to die, and to have their own vision of how humanity is supposed to look like. And basically, just to explain more what in their mind is, I got to explain that they do believe in Darwin. They believe that since they're atheists and they don't believe in God, and they believe in a coincidental development of evolution of planet Earth and condition of life and life on Earth out of a materialistic way than a matter, then they don't believe in God. They believe in nature. And now they see what they see is, since they claim that everything is only natural, there is no transcendental power or above nature or God, so therefore they think that they should be God, because they claim that there is a survival fight, just like in the jungle, in the same way in the human field, because in human history, because we are only a type of animals. So therefore, that's the way they view us, view themselves. So therefore, there is a fight in the jungle between the animals over natural sources, over and basically the rules of the jungle is the strong is living and the weak is supposed to be wiped out, and therefore they want to wipe out the weak because they claim that it's impossible to go on like that when the quantity of humanity is growing and growing and growing, and the quality of life is being reduced more and more, more and more and more, and basically we're growing natural growth, but usually the big families are the poor families and the less educated people, and therefore they think that they need to actively be involved to improve humanity, that becoming more and more stupid and becoming more and more poor and less educated, and to improve humanity. And also because there is a fight over land and over natural sources and over fuel, and because there is a tear apart of in the ozone and X-ray that coming into the atmosphere, and they do believe also that we, as a human being, we are the enemy of nature, because we breathe oxygen, and we pollute the air by CO2, and we cause global warming in the planet Earth, that soon gonna lose its capability to hold life, and the condition of life on planet Earth will be gone. So therefore, there is no, according to philosophy, there is no other choice but getting rid of most of the population on Earth and the weak. But the question is, who is the weak? Who are those weak people, undesirable people, and who are those strong people? Therefore, if we tend to look at that philosophy, Hitler used also to hold that same strategy. But he thought that the Aryan race is the top race, and the Jews race is the lower weak race that's supposed to be wiped out. That's what he felt, because he had his own philosophy, and I'm not going to get into it. It's not the right place to really dig into his Hitler philosophy. He wrote the book, Mein Kampf, and then he was explaining why the Jewish nation is supposed to be wiped out. He claimed that they live above nature, their own lifestyle, unnatural life, and they committed to a supreme power of God, and therefore they deny nature, and according to him there is only natural power that created us, and therefore we are not thankful enough toward nature, and we're supposed to be wiped out by natural, in a natural way, because we don't accept nature, we don't tend to appreciate nature. But it doesn't really matter what Hitler thought, because after the Second World War, He was defeated, but many people don't know that Hitler was defeated only militantically, but not conceptualically. But because his concept, the concept of New World Order, still exists, and the concept of the praise and the lower race and the weak and the strong, it's part of the evolution theory and the survival fight that they think that they exist in nature, and a food chain that exists in nature, and a fight between different kind of animals so that exist in nature. So therefore, it's part of their philosophy. Therefore, they decide something completely else after the Second World War. They're more open, and they're not races, but they think that the strong people are the people that Hon-Vashilton, that control humanity through, politicians that have power, because the population vote them to guide them. So they're the strongest people and the top people of humanity that's supposed to be live, and also the wise people of science and that have, genius brain and represent geniosity of humanity, and the wealthy people that were able to fight the survival fight and to climb to the top through money, through wealth, and those are the people that are supposed to the greatest people of humanity. So therefore, now the mafia basically they betrayed humanity, the population, and it's a mafia of Hon Vashilton, of people that are in power and in control, and have wealth and politicians and control through governments. Those are the people that's supposed to go on and live, and most of the people are supposed to be poor people, supposed to be wiped out. Therefore, what I see is we see their philosophy. We see that they're getting more and more power, gaining more and more power. And we see that they're capable of building 800 concentration camps around America. And you understand what's behind it. They even wrote it in books. There is in Georgia a place where there is a huge stones that they wrote their agenda in Sanskrit, in some other languages, in Russian, in English. I think that even in Hebrew, I don't really recall, but I know that it, in many languages, they want to wipe out 90% of humanity, which is the Fourth Reich being planned to humanity. We got to understand that the Jews, that God allowing them to play for the time being to show humanity that without him, the evilness will control humanity and bring humanity to a self-destruction. So therefore, they have to seek him and to ask him to get involved in human history. So it's definitely going to take place, because we have, as a Jewish people, covenant through Mount Sinai, covenant with God, between God and humanity through the nation of Israel as a testifying people, that when we're going to keep the Torah and the mitzvot, then God will get involved, and he's all obligated. It's not that only we obligate to keep the commands and the Torah and the ketshuva and the tefillah and study Torah day and night, but also the covenant is God is committed to the nation of Israel. He will get involved because of the covenant of Mount Sinai with the nation of Israel in the field of human history to save humanity, the nation of Israel, from its evilness, from the new world order. But it's according to our Gemara, we do know, first of all, we know that the power to save humanity, we are the light of the nations, just like the prophet Ishayahu say, "V'alchu goim le'orech u'melachim le'nogazorchech," that the nations will walk behind us through after our light and after our shining light of the nation of Israel, of Knesset Israel. Just like the prophet Ishayah was saying, that the darkness and the Rafael, which is a fog or a darkness, it's covering earth, covering the nations. And the and light of God is shining upon Knesset Israel, upon the nation of Israel, and therefore we have to guide humanity and to save them by what mean. Naturally, there is no way; it's a dead end because the New World Order already gained control over UN. Basically, they founded UN. And United Nations, and they control, it's basically, everything is under the Club of Rome, which is the top of the pyramid, and the kingdom in England, and, they have the Bilderberg Group, and they have the CFR, Council on Foreign Relations in the United States, which is the media power, and controlling the mass population through the media, and their, thoughts and knowledge by giving limitation to their knowledge through the media because they control the news, and through the bankers of Wall Street because they control the money and the power and the World Bank, and therefore and the Federal Reserve and Bohemian Grove, which is a club of the mafia. And we got to understand one thing: the Three Sides group, which is another group of people that consider those three components, which is the money, Wall Street, the politicians, Bilderberg, the media, and the public relations of the mafia, which is the CFR, and basically they take all the information and they put them together and give orders to Obama and to the White House. Therefore, we got to understand as the Jews are supposed to run from America. I just want to increase awareness by saying that any one of us that live in Central America is supposed to consider the fact that the American government released a document to the population and explaining what's going to take place in case of an emergency. The President of the United States can make a decision on his own and to change the government from a civil government to a martial law or a federal government. And martial law is going to take place. What exactly are the law, the martial law? There is a detail details that being presented to the public, that in case of a martial law, all the airports in America will be shut down automatically. So nobody going to be able to escape America in case of a martial law. Nobody can wait for the last minute and then say, okay, when the martial law will take place, then I'm going to run away from America, because all the airports will be shut down automatically. All the foods, it doesn't really matter if you have a grocery or you have a store or whatever. It doesn't really matter. Storage, all the foods will belong automatically to the federal government. And all the vehicles in America will belong to the federal government. They're allowed to remove any group of people from any place to any place that they see. That the federal government will decide to remove. And we do know that there is railroads from the big cities to the concentration camps, and there is a trains sitting and waiting on the railroads and sitting empty. All those things, if anyone really want to see them, then you can see them. It's available to the public. I know that the Haredi community, they don't enter to the internet, but in YouTube, it's possible to see things. And people that don't enter to the internet, then it's okay. But we got to be at least aware of of their existence, because now it's become a dangerous place to live in a country where those are the rules, and that's the reality around it. We got to understand that in case of a martial law, then it's become to be a federal government, and then it's a military control, and then the rules are going to change rapidly, and America would not look the way you view it now. And we got to understand that the concentration camps can hold 50 million people, and the question is, who are those people that's supposed to be there? Now, there is many excuses to the government just because of the September 11 occur, then a lot of fear in the public a question, or people were seeking solution to ask from the government to solve the problem, because 3,000 people were killed. And what's going to take place? The people were asking, keep asking, what's going to happen when America going to fight with the Arabs? Maybe there is 7 million Arabs inside America, then they can be fifth column, and they can fight from the inside from America. Then maybe the concentration camps is what waiting for, just in case of what the Arabs they're going to fight with America. But the point is that there's only 7 million Arabs there. And the concentration camps are capable of containing 50 million people. Maybe the illegal people, illegal alien, maybe the Jewish people, maybe increase of anti-Semitism inside America, then America will not be able to protect the Jews, and then they're gonna provide them with the solution of the concentration camps. Well, I would like to share with you, I got a phone call from Oliver Stern from Bnei Brak, and he told me that Rabbi Yehuda Zev Leibovich, which is a tzaddik nistar in Bnei Brak, that all the rabbis, all the admorim used to go to him and to ask him, was a Gaon Yesod Olam, and he is being considered as one of the Lamed Vav tzaddikim. And when he, right before he died, he told Rabbi Shtam that, go to America and tell to the population of America, the Jewish communities, to leave America, to hurry to leave America, to rush to leave America, because the president, whomever it may be, he may be, will turn to become the second Hitler. So I'm just sharing with you what I got through a phone call from Rabbi Shtam from Bnei Brak, which called me, and I'm reminding you that Rabbi Chaim Kanievsky also directed a call to the Jewish community a month and a half ago. And I'm encouraging you to listen to the Gdolei Israel, saying, come back, come make an aliyah, come to Israel, live here, because America is going to turn to a very dangerous place to live in the end of time. And I know that Rabbi, the Remenov Rabbi, is going walking in Florida and explaining and trying to encourage people to leave America and to make an aliyah to Israel. Don't think that you're coming, government of Israel, think that you're coming to the land of God, that God will protect you. Come with faith and understand that, yeah, I know that many Americans, when they see what's going on here in Israel, they tend to think that America is a safe place. Don't go by your eyes. Don't go by your heart. Basically, the Shekhinah right now, the holiness of God, that just like Patach Eliyahu is saying, Eliyahu Navi was saying, you, Knesset Israel, you thought that when the destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem, then my holiness, my Shekhinah, left earth to heaven. No, that's not the case. The Shekhinah went with the nation of Israel to the exile. But right now, it's the time when the Shekhinah is leaving exile and coming back to Har HaMoriah, to Eretz Yisrael. And we, the Jewish people, are the son of the Shekhinah. We must do the same and come to the land of Israel, because what's going to take place now over the earth, it's the third world war. They're going to fight, nations will fight with one another, because the Shekhinah is leaving. And now they're won't be a peace around the world. It's going to be a tornado of war that's going to turn rapidly more and more, and then it's going to be just like a tornado and hurricane of fight between the nations. And yes, you're right. The eye of that tornado will come and be here around Jerusalem, because in New World Order, they want Jerusalem as their capital, and they want that Eretz Yisrael will be international and to control the world from here, from Jerusalem, as their capital. Why is it? Because they want to defeat the city and the country of the holy country of those three religions and Jerusalem as the of the city of the three big religion of the West in its house, in their house. So they want to wipe them out, the atheist people. They want to control through Seder Olami Chadash, New World Order, from Eretz Yisrael to the world. So, but don't fear that. We have to fear God. We have to fear the Word of God. We have to go with the vision of the Bible and to understand that the eye of the hurricane is the most safe place to be, because everything around it is going to be wiped out, just like in any hurricane. But the safest place will be Bnei Hashem Elokecha Ba'a Mireshit Hashanah Vadachit Hashanah Eretz Yisrael Jerusalem, going to be the safest place in the Third World War. And we got to understand that here, yes, it's going to be the greatest fear that's going to be in anywhere around the world, but the point is that it's going to be only fear here. But around the world will be destruction. People will get killed. There will be a world holocaust. But here in Israel, it's going to be the sheep of Noah from the flood of fire. And here it's going to be the Tzion Tiat Leta. Tzion is going to be the redemption, the safest place to be, and people will live here. The fear is going to be here. Its purpose is that people that go by nature only, and they don't have faith in God, they're going to leave Israel. They're going to leave Israel straight to the concentration camps, straight to leave Israel straight to the dangerous places. But people that hold to the vision and to the prophecies and to the promises of God will hold above nature and stay here and be saved. V'sh'arti b'kirbech am ani v'dal v'chasu b'shem Hashem. Sherit Yisrael asher lo yasu avla. Those people that are going to be here and hold to the promises of God, they're going to turn fear to confidence. They're going to turn fear to faith in God. They're going to pray that and tzipita le Yeshua. I mean, they're going to expect that God will get involved in human history above nature and redeem them. And that's what's going to take place. People that are going to be able to win the situation will come here, because that's the place to survive. And therefore, I'm encouraging you, all the people in Central America and Canada and South America and around the world, be aware that the Shekhinah is living the exile, and now everything going to turn there will be no peace there. There will be only a war and fight between nations, and it's going to get more and more till we're going to reach Third World War. It's not gonna be quiet no more. It's just gonna climb and climb and climb, and I know that they're gonna turn that against us, and they're gonna come and blame us, and we expect it. But we got to understand, God is doing it on a purpose to take a revenge of the destruction of the first and second temple, because those two temples were destroyed by the Ismailite rays and by the Edomite rays, the second temple. So therefore, God is bringing them here to Israel to fight with one another and to kill one another on the land of Jerusalem. Just like the Zechariah is saying. And the last turn will be that Ishmael will fall before the Edomite 9 months, before the Messiah is going to come. And those nine months are basically to deliver the pregnancy and the deliverance of the redemption by those end of 9 months. And then Mashiach, the son of David, will come. Now, through the prophecies, through the scriptures, through the Talmud, through the Midrashim, we do know that only through the nation of Israel and the transcendental power of God that live among us inside Knesset Israel, and we have covenant with God from Mount Sinai, we as a Jewish nation can operate transcendental power and bring God through the covenant between us and Him, because He is obligated to us to operate inside human history to defeat the evilness of the New World Order through us. And we can save humanity, entire humanity, from the private hands of those people that want to wipe out 90% of the population of humanity. I'm directing that lecture and I'm trying to remind you that Rabbi Chaim Kanievsky were directing his a month and a half ago his voice to the community, the Jewish community in America, saying come back to Israel. I know that many people that are trying to reach out and to give lectures that ask from Rabbi Kanievsky to go and give lectures around the world and to leave Israel. He told them no, don't go. And so therefore, I'm saying to anyone that lives in America should consider that we are not in the regular time, but we are approaching the landing, and therefore the landing of the plan of human history, which is a redemption of the end of time, and the Third World War coming. And as we, everybody can feel it, but they don't exactly know what they feel. But the real nature of nature, it's not what we see. The real nature of nature, it's just like in heaven when Adam and Eve were inside Gan Eden before they committed the ancient sin. And that's the real nature of nature. And everything that the atheist people are relying on, it's a result of the sin, because survival fight and the food chain and the fight between different kind of animals, all what they see and they translate as evilness in nature, it's basically the result of the ancient sin. But soon as when the Messiah will come and we're going to be able to fix this ancient sin by Torah and mitzvot and to fix it, then they will not have any head or tail to rely on, because they rely, their point is that's the way they translate nature as evil. There is no that's not the real nature of nature. Sameach tesamach, ra'im ahuvim, kesamechacha yetzircha, began eden mikedem, chadesh yamenu kekedem. We pray that God will renew our times, just like in ancient times of Adam and Eve in Eden. Therefore, the real nature of nature, it's good, not evil. There is no food chain, the gals vevin keves, and amirim bidir bat. Sheep and a lion will eat together grass over the field that will not kill one another. And that's the real nature of nature. Therefore, everything will go back to the good nature which God created it. But the atheist people basically have no appreciation to nature. They view it as evil, and therefore, if according to their vision, since there is no God, they turn themselves to become God instead, and therefore they don't even see it as a moral problem, because they think that since there is no choice, because otherwise all the entire humanity will wipe out, that therefore we have to choose, at least we as a strong people and wise people, we're going to live and wipe out the mass population. Therefore, I'm saying you got to understand, we as the Jews being considered as the greatest enemy of the atheist people, because we we are threatening the consciousness of humanity and conquering the consciousness of humanity by delivering and spreading the concept of God and transcendental power above nature, which they don't like, and therefore they fight the Bible, they fight Jews, people, they fight Hashem, the Meshicho. And I thank you for listening to the lecture, and hope that you're going to be able to grasp the material and understand what I was saying, and make the right conclusion. And we hope that the nation of Israel will be redeemed as soon as possible. We're going to pray for it, that everyone, every Jew will be redeemed, and that we're going to be able to enlighten nations, not to go with the Amalekite and the evilness of the world. That's why we sacrifice in Sukkot, tabernacles, we sacrifice 70 sacrifice for all the nations, so we can draw them from the Amalekite, from the atheism point of view, from the rejection of God, to believe in God. השם אלוקי ישראל מלאך מלכותו בכל משלה, אמן סלה. I thank you for listening, and good night.